Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back, some of the familiar faces. And a special welcome to Ash Amin and Razia Iqbal, who will be at the symposium tomorrow. So this talk, From the Feminine to Feminism, Women in Islamic Thought and Literature, is not really about poverty, development, or women's struggles as such. Those are not my research areas, and I know probably as much as most people who know from what they hear in the media and read in the media. It's really about some of the images that are defining women's struggle, and also the kind of images that we can't quite encapsulate what they mean in terms of gender struggles. By gender, I'm really narrowing it down to male-female relationships here. Conversations about women and gender-related issues in Islam have been dominated by concerns of rights and justice. As the world has moved gradually towards a discourse of individual rights and social justice, this is hardly surprising. Diverse feminist perspectives highlight the reality of women's lives in many parts of the Islamic world, and either critique patriarchal structures or explain away Qur'anic verses according to the 7th century contexts. They maintain, almost without exception, that contrary to popular perceptions, there are no identified roles for women in the Qur'an, and that the Qur'an gives spiritual egalitarianism to both men and women, however unequal or unjust social structures might be. But this socio-historical emphasis has almost eclipsed the variety of images of the feminine which are also to be found in Islamic thought, literature, and piety. When one looks at the richness of images, one is left wondering whether the reality of women's lives is really somewhere between both struggles and ideals, what I would call the feminine and the feminist. In my many years of teaching aspects of gender and ethics in Islam to undergrad students, it occurs to me that students year in and year out ask the same questions about women and Islam or women in Islam. Words like role, status, position attached to women reflect the need to understand the feminine and the feminist in Muslim societies through neatly constructed ideas which can be traced back to the Quran and other religious sources. Their ideas and understandings are based on what they hear and read in the media, see on the streets, and perceive to be the strangely divided world of male-female relations in Muslim societies. But as they explore these issues in greater depth, they begin to realize that no discourse, intellectual, religious, or popular, can encapsulate the complex literary reflections of women in Islamic history, nor the lived realities of women's lives within Islam, as in any other religious tradition or society. And slowly, the students begin to relax. My purpose here is not to underplay the religious, social, and relational discriminations many women live with, especially in Muslim societies, on a daily level. It's rather to say that our emphasis on the struggle for recognition, justice, and respect, as well as that most elusive ideal, equality, is a modern discourse. And the classical traditions of most religions, including Islam, while trying to give and protect certain rights for women, were not unduly concerned with rights and equality in the way we are concerned with these issues today. Our consciousness of equality and justice issues has gone through a huge transformation in the last few decades. And while many a struggle remains everywhere in the world, there are some milestones. For example, the second half of the 20th century saw the UN Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, gender equality acquired a clearer and more urgent imperative. These kinds of international agreements, however contested and effective, will speak of an aspiration for a different kind of ethics, where the moral imperative for justice for all demands listening to all. But when we look at women's portrayal through the prism of contemporary notions of rights and justice, we get only a partial picture of complex and more subtle realities. I just want to give a short history of where I think we are with some of the bigger narratives. The whole gender debate in Islam has in the last century focused specifically on select verses of the Quran, a text which, like all other monotheist scriptures, has been reproached for or used for gender bias in favor of men. These particular readings have subsequently found their own place within the traditional madhabs of the law schools, which in turn have been used and accused of fossilizing this discrimination, and thereby reducing lesser status than men on many levels. Of course, gender relations means far more than equality between the sexes. Ultimately, gender relations lie at the very essence of how a society behaves spiritually, psychologically, socially, and economically. But one of the central concerns, right from the beginning, was women's dress. An enormous amount has already been said on this single issue, and yet it is still as important today as it was in the initial stages of this debate. Women's clothing was about women's honor, and this in turn was about the social morality of Muslim communities. And so in the 19th century, Arabs who had either visited the West or been educated in the West, such as Qasim Amin and Rifat Tahtawi, targeted particular issues and in their own way championed what they saw as opening new avenues for women. Amin focused on the veil and female seclusion in general as indicative of the social backwardness of Islamic societies. Unless women were educated in a formal sense, he argued, Arab societies could not prosper. Huda Sharawi, who died in 1947, the founder of the Egyptian Feminist Union, was to emphasize this unease with the veil even more when she took her veil off in public on her return from the International Union of Women in Rome. The whole debate was complex and highly charged, and remains so even today, as can be seen by some of the literature, which claims that not only is veiling and segregation not grounded in the Quran, but that since the abolition of slavery, only women and minorities are left as a test for the state to modernize itself and to bring its laws into conformity with the principle of equality. Women may not be the political leaders of the Islamic world, but they are always a political tool. But I would argue, actually, it's not just the Islamic world. Muslim women's voices did start to speak out, vociferously questioning from a female perspective, from a female reading of history and scripture, why the totality of humanity had only been partially recognized, been partially free, and in the end been totally silent, except for containing exemplary and glorified figures that lived either in an idealized past, such as the Prophet's youngest wife Aisha, his daughters Fatima, the mothers of the believers in general, or in the Quranic narrative, such as Maryam or Bilqis. On the one hand, these figures provided select evidence for the argument that women had not been absent from the development of Islam as a culture and civilization. In fact, they'd made a significant contribution to Islam in its genesis and to its spread. But on the other hand, how had subsequent centuries of Islamic thought deliberately disengaged ordinary believing women as much as possible from both public and other central arenas of society? They argued that the androcentric interpretation of scripture, which had permeated both the political and the personal areas of Islamic societies, both fed into and fed off the patriarchal ideologies upon which so much of Islam was institutionally established. They further maintained that in the areas of personal law, the laws of marriage, divorce, child custody, etc., women had been unjustly discriminated against, because male interpretation had so forcefully, so subtly, and so successfully convinced Islamic familial and social structures that this was God's will. This was God's prescribed moral and social order, where women had a rightful place from which any movement may well be a compromise of their virtue and honor. So all notions of justice, the right to seek knowledge, has been distorted in the light of this experience. There are, of course, women activists such as Seema Wali, who look at the Afghan women refugee crisis, such as in Pakistan, where the problem of the uprooted Muslim women has not been sufficiently addressed within any type of feminist discourse. Shahabuddin's work, I think her first name is Elora, Shahabuddin's work on rural Bangladeshi women and the obstacles they face in seeking help from local NGOs on the basis that they aim to proselytize. She also comments movingly on the largely unchallenged role of the village religious leaders, the Salish, who accuse Muslim women and men of sexual misconduct, mainly adultery, and call for the severest of penalties. For both the secularists and the Islamists, the rural masses are a homogeneous group, and little regard is given to individual cases or individual identity. Those who speak with pseudonyms against oppressive regimes in which women are primary targets of oppression and violence, as highlighted in the voices speaking out against fundamentalist killings in Algeria as a result of the Islamic Salvation Front, know that they are opening themselves to assassination or severe reprisals. In fact, at the time, Karima Banune argued, no group of women was as reviled by the fundamentalist ideologues in the 1980s and 90s as the women activists who attempted to organize against the 1984 Family Code, the 1990 electoral law, and for greater rights for women in Algerian society. And she argued that although improvement was made through the work of activists, the activists themselves are the biggest threat to armed regimes because they are public women, denigrated as women who are products of Western colonialism, essentially women who pose the ultimate challenge to the desired state order. But over the last 30 years or so, with an increasing attention since 9/11, much of the feminist thinking seems to still be polarized between an Orientalist and an Islamist discourse, respectively, often ignoring the variety of indigenous Muslim debates through which women order their lives, their identities, and their relationships. The headline stories of veiling and segregation divide opinion, as do the validity of such practices as women's seclusion, arranged marriages, punishment of disobedient daughters, and various other customary practices. But I argue that most women seem to continue to live what could be termed as normal lives. Their identities are now more widely seen as fluid and in a process of continuous negotiation and renegotiation through everyday practices and discourses. Experience is shaped by specific cultural milieus and varies according to one's class, age, ethnicity, religion, sexuality, and nationality. Although there are particular constructions of femininity within certain contexts that are normative or dominant, there is no monolithic or homogeneous femininity. In other words, there is no one way to be a Muslim woman. However obvious and simplistic that may sound, it remains one of the most difficult discussions to get across, because women are constantly used as reflections of liberal or conservative societies. And perhaps this is the crux of it all. Feminism is still a very revolutionary idea. It demands that women's rights to make choices are recognized, but more importantly, that the choices they make hold real value in the value systems of our societies. For many Muslim women, the real struggle is how they reconcile their faith, their cultural traditions, and their immediate family context with the overarching impetus of feminism, which is driven on the right to self-autonomy. This means at time taking risks, going against community expectations, and I would argue that for some it can be the biggest jihad of their lives. The heterogeneity of the Muslim world, the different voices, moralities and lifestyles are completely lost in many of the generalizations made about women in Islam. There is an immense amount of work being done, not just by academic and activists, but also by ordinary women across the Islamic world to raise consciousness of many of the issues to which many Western feminists refer. But the important point here is that most of these women are not rejecting the Muslim faith itself in their struggle for better and more just societies. Most revisit the scriptural tradition in the claim that the Quranic worldview is essentially egalitarian in spirit, and that society itself has failed to translate this world into any meaningful reality. They argue human rights are Islamic, not that Islam is subservient to Western notions of human rights. There are others, like the Iranian-born Mehnaz Afkami, who say, women have inalienable rights. The epistemology of Islam is contrary to women's rights, but you can use what you need to advance women's positions. I call myself a Muslim and a feminist, she argues. I'm not an Islamic feminist. That's a contradiction in terms. Certain feminist works have expressed dismay at the continuing presence of exegesis of the Quranic basis for Islamic practice and doctrine about women. And Kenneth Craggs surmised that Islamic feminism faces an acute tactical dilemma, whether to retrieve and maximize in their favor all that they can from the Quran, or whether directly to plead secular grounds which have to write off the sacred text as affording only dubiously equivocal support. According to most social science research, women are influenced by the discourse of femininity, regardless of how it's expressed, because it constitutes, and I quote, what it means to be a woman, and in so doing, controls the behaviour of individual women. Women think about what it means to be a woman in ways that affects their attitudes to all kinds of situations in life. And social scientists make various claims. As an ideological concept, femininity denotes how women should look and behave. It is a romantic sentiment, a nostalgic tradition of imposed limitations. These are all quotes. To be feminine requires effort. It necessitates, argues, a labor of production rather than an expression of nature. Masculinity, in contrast, does not require day-to-day maintenance. I'm sure that's not true, actually. Ideas of normative femininity are focused on the female body and appearance, and it is women who, through self-regulation of their bodies, conform to this ideal. And then, of course, that most famous phrase of the 1970s, when Simone de Beauvoir furthered the awareness of the social and cultural construction of femininity, promoting the idea that there is nothing inherent or natural about femininity, when she said, one is not born a woman, but rather becomes one. While I can understand the reasoning in the social construct ideas, I actually don't find them very convincing. For example, a central issue related to femininity is motherhood. One could argue that motherhood is given the highest status in Islamic thought, with hadiths such as, paradise lies at the feet of the mother. But beyond such traditions, the role has stayed and continues to stay, if not the most important, along with appearance and nurturing, one of the most important goals for Muslim women today, in how they actually define their femininity. Motherhood is still seen by many as not defining a regressive domestication, but the ultimate reflection of what it means to be a woman. Asfar Siraj's empirical work on Muslim women and their ideas of femininity confirmed this as remaining a particular goal in women's lives. But she first lays out some of the way feminists, mainly in the West, have portrayed motherhood. And she quotes, women's roles as mothers is a central component of the discourse of femininity, because motherhood is an enactment of femininity. But according to Simone de Beauvoir, there is no such thing as a maternal instinct. It is a patriarchal invention which infuses maternal guilt within women. Oakley argues that mothers are not born, but made, while Hoffnung refers to the myth of the maternal instinct as a motherhood mystique, the idea that women in their role as mothers are most suitable for the care of others, and contends that the womb, the ultimate source of this power, has historically been turned against us and itself made into a source of powerlessness. The feminine ideal encourages women's domestic and maternal responsibilities as natural and encompasses this ideal as intuitive, empathetic and caring. Julia Kristeva stated that we live in a civilization where the consecrated, religious or secular, representation of femininity is absorbed by motherhood. For Kristeva, the mother's existence is where nature confronts culture. And she further articulates that the only discourse of maternity in Western culture is through religion and science. In religion, the mother is sacred. In science, the mother represents nature. In a 2009 essay, the philosopher and cultural theorist Slavoj Žižek asserted that the feminine is a secret, repressed history of Islam. By referring to the story of Abraham and his slave girl Hagar, who bore him his first son Ishmael but remained unnamed in the Quran, Žižek concluded that despite the pivotal role of the feminine, it remains repressed in the archives of Islam. But contesting that unnamed does not mean absent, Mahdi Turaj pays homage to the women of early Islam, who played a significant role in the life of the Prophet, such as his wives, Khadija and Aisha, but also those who preserved and disseminated Islamic sources. Turaj agrees with most women writing on Islam and gender that the unfolding Islamic civilizations, however, and unfortunately, were far more androcentric, even misogynist in their approach, resulting in the repression of the feminine voice from the archives. But the feminine is never totally erased, even though when she is mentioned, it is often in the male imaginary. For example, and this is one of the images I wanted to talk about, the name of that most famous Sufi woman of Islamic history, the 8th century mystic Rabia al-Adawiyya, is often brought up in discussions of a positive view of women. But even an exceptional female mystic like Rabia assumes the gender value of a male. She becomes an honorary man. In his monumental book, The Memorial of the Saints, the 13th century Persian mystic Fariduddin Attar includes Rabia amongst all the best among the all-male cast of extraordinary mystics. He has to apologetically begin the discussion by pointing out that an exceptional woman can no longer be called a woman. She is a man. Staying with Sufism allows us to explore a particular issue in women's reflection of their devotion and femininity. But a curious dialectic is to be found in Sufism. The image of the Sufi seeker consumed by desire for the divine essence, sometimes described as beautiful, veiled, beloved, is given a good deal of poetic and rhetorical play in the work of Sufi literature. The image derives much of its symbolic force from the assumption that the Sufi seeker is himself the male lover, seeking the sublime divine essence, metaphorically conceived of in feminine terms. But the feminine presence in Sufism is not merely a symbolic one, as women are also among the well-known practitioners of the mystical path. And a number of Sufi works clearly show that, the most famous being Rabia, that they made a huge impact on Sufi thought. Rabia is frequently credited with pioneering the Sufi doctrine of divine love, and passionate descriptions of devotion towards God are ascribed to many Sufi women. But as Maryam Dekaki has shown in her excellent work, while in many ways the devotional attitudes of Sufi women are similar to those reported of Sufi men, the words attributed to early Sufi women suggest that they developed their own image of the divine beloved as both gentle and strong, fiercely jealous and disarmingly intimate, and metaphorically conceptualized as a masculine object of their female longing. At the same time, descriptions of their spiritual relationship with the beloved tend to be less exotic and more domesticated. She writes, rather than conceiving of their souls as lovers journeying in quest of an elusive rendezvous with the beloved, the Sufi women are more frequently imagining their souls as faithful lovers enjoying regular intimacy with God. While both male and female Sufis speak of intimacy with God, much of the literature of female mystics speaks of intimacy as a specific motif of women on divine love. Intimacy is a technical term in Sufism and considered the highest station on the mystical path to God, when the seeker desires nothing but God and is overcome with joy and nearness. Ghazali, that most famous theologian polymath, said, "One who is overcome by the state of intimacy desires nothing but solitude and seclusion, because intimacy with God requires separation from all that is other than God." So for a person in such a state of intimacy, the practices of solitude and social withdrawal, the classic elements of the ascetic life, are driven not by fear, but by love. Sufi women also wept over their own moral unworthiness, but felt that a real relationship with God could only result in ecstatic joy. One woman claimed that her sins were too meager for her to worry about divine chastisement, while another anticipated a joyful afterlife, not because of her good works, but simply because she loved God. When a man asked her how she can be so certain of her own salvation, she replies with a rhetorical question, "Do you think God would torment me when I love him?" The certitude many Sufi women had in their own state of mutual love and attachment with God seemed to enhance their desire to preserve themselves exclusively of God and to see themselves as his. As Dekaki writes, sometimes the female mystic's harshness and detachment towards earthly pleasures and men was not necessarily a denial or rejection of their feminine virtue, or even of this important Islamic institution of marriage. It was simply a determination to direct all their feminine devotion and love towards the only spouse worthy of it, God himself. This kind of literature reflects a passion and warmth which Sufi women were proud of as women and as Sufis. They did not see in their worship of God, in their path, anything which was less than male devotion, quite the opposite. And while this can't be equated with women having a public voice in religious life, a very contemporary struggle, It would appear that for those who sought a deeper spiritual awareness of God, there were no obstacles, male or material. Of course, the more general Sufi portrayal of women was far more mixed, where women were the source of good and bad. And it is said that in the 13th century mystic, Ibn Arabi, was against being with women in his path to God, until he came across the prophetic hadith, "Three things from your world are made beloved to me, women, perfume, and prayer." He then began to show love for women and saw his persona change, turning into a far more compassionate person. The second image I wanted to talk about is really the discussion of women with the motifs of the Arabian Nights. The Arabian Nights, the Alif Layla wa Layla, or as in Persian, the Hazar Afsaneh. I don't know how many of you know about the Arabian Nights, but I have found this actually quite fascinating. Some of the stories of this collection, which were added over the years, such as Sinbad, Ali Baba, and Aladdin, have of course been immortalized by Disney. But basically, Scheherazade's tale is the ultimate tale of a woman overpowering her master, not with her beauty or wiles, but with her intellect and charm. Seduction is not understood as body language, but communication. These stories are written in a simple style depicting a world full of powerful sorcerers, jinn, huge wealth, bawdry sexual tactics and liaisons, tragedies and comedies. And while they're considered to be a long way off from the refined classical Arabic literature, in the non-Arab world, especially in the West, the Alif Layla stories have, through the medium of translation, achieved the status of a universal classic. The main frame story is about a Persian king, Shahryar, and his new bride. He's shocked to discover that his brother's wife is unfaithful, but then he discovers that his own wife is unfaithful, and he becomes even more angry. He has her executed. But in his bitterness and grief, he decides that all women are the same. All are capable of infidelity. Shahryar begins to marry a succession of virgins, only to execute each one the next morning, before she has a chance to dishonor him. Eventually, the vizier, whose duty it is to provide him with virgins, is getting worried because there are so few women left. Scheherazade, the vizier's daughter, offers herself as the next bride, and her father reluctantly agrees. Scheherazade is convinced that she will not be executed. On the night of their marriage, Scheherazade asks her sister, Dunyazade, to come into her room after the king has had his fill of her and ask her to tell her some story to pass the night. Her sister does that, and this way Scheherazade begins to tell the king a tale, but she never ends it. The king, curious about how the story ends, is thus forced to postpone her execution in order to hear the conclusion. The next night, as soon as she finishes the tale, she begins another story, and the king, eager to hear the conclusion, postpones her execution again. And so it goes on for 1,001 nights. Literary figure only, but still a symbol of something quite empowering. Each story is a story of her salvation. She has to have the king's audience to survive each night. And each story is a ransom paid for another living day. She manages to do this by her power and intellect, not through sex. Fatima Mernissi's intriguing and enjoyable little book, and if you haven't read it, I really would recommend it, Scheherazade Goes West, in which she traces how Western writers and painters have depicted this heroine, has amusing anecdotes about how the East and the West imagine women, ideal or real. Scheherazade is a symbol of intellectual power, wit, and female survival, and is used as a motif throughout Mernissi's book. But in her journey through the art world of Paris, Mernissi learns much. She learns that the French playwright Molière made fun of women who aspired to be educated. In Les Femmes Savantes and other plays, women who aspired to educate themselves, especially about science, were portrayed as repulsive and ugly. One of Molière's male characters stresses how much he dislikes educated women. And I don't know why I'm smiling, but every time I read this, I smile. Intellectual women are not to my taste. I grant you, a woman should know all sorts of things, but I cannot abide a woman who feels a deplorable urge to learn, simply to become learned. When such matters crop up in conversation, I'd rather she knew enough to know what she knows. The 17th century may have been the century of the Enlightenment, of reason and humanism, but it was also the century of Molière and others who belittled women's deluded audacity to be learned. Mernissi also learns about Immanuel Kant, that he had a very ambivalent attitude towards women, about whom he said many things, but this is one of his quotes. A woman is embarrassed little that she does not possess high quality insights, that she is timid and not fit for serious employment. She is beautiful and captivates, and that is enough. But one cannot talk of female sexuality without talking of dress. What people wear, and especially what Muslim women wear, seems to be revealing more about the onlooker than the woman herself. But why what women wear in particular? Well, as the director of CRASSH, Simon Goldhill, says, in speaking of the Greek concept of the canon of the perfect body, a woman can be sexy, beautiful, healthy, but her body is subject to the regulation and control of men, and it cannot form a canon. A woman cannot be looked at in the same way that a man can. In relation to how men in different cultures understand a woman's intelligence and beauty, Mernissi makes a witty point about patriarchal control when it comes to female clothing, where she critiques how Eastern and Western men differ in their imagination and the harem. She has just seen the painting of the Grand Odalisque by the French neoclassical painter Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres. And in a conversation with her friend Jacques, who is showing her the museums and art galleries of Paris, and who insists that the women in his own harem must be nude and silent, she replies with some curiosity how both the men of the East and the West conceptualize women. She says, Muslim men seem to get a virile power from veiling women and harassing them in the streets if they aren't covered properly, while Western men like yourself seem to derive a tremendous pleasure from unveiling them. Unveiling and silencing seemed a strange paradox, but it was what Mernissi discovered had happened to Scheherazade, the storyteller, in the images and accounts of her life when the West discovered her. Beauty and silence went hand in hand when it came to the fantasy of an ideal woman. The Muslim woman had to be redrawn as a silent and passive woman. But Mernissi reflects on the powerful women in Islamic history, such as Queen Nur Jahan, the wife of the 17th century Emperor Jahangir, women who were beautiful, sporty, brilliant in the arts, and held huge influence over their husband's power and wealth. When Matisse saw an Islamic art exhibition in 1910, miniatures of Turkish women throwing away their veils and flying aeroplanes, he said, "Persian miniatures show me the full possibility of my sensations." Muslim women, when depicted in rich artwork, were always powerful and seductive through being active, while gradually she realizes that eroticism in Western painting was always a male observer looking at a nude woman he paralyzes in a frame. Staying with clothing, she then relates her own slightly bewildering but amusing experience of entering a Parisian clothes shop and being told her that her hips were too big for any of the clothes there. She was clearly not a size 6, and when asked what size she was, she said, a little embarrassed, "I come from a country where there is no size for women's clothes." She confessed that in Morocco, no one cares about anyone's size, to which the very thin shopkeeper exclaims in disbelief, "You mean you don't watch your weight?" Many women working in highly paid fashion-related jobs would lose their positions if they didn't keep to a strict diet. Mernissi concludes, "Her words were so simple, but the threat they implied was so cruel that I realized for the first time that maybe a size 6 is a more violent restriction imposed on women than the Muslim veil." The fallout from our current veiling burqa debate has seeped into the political and philosophical consciousness of the West, where it's become a regular reminder of the different views of conceptualizing gender, women, but also how different cultures can choose to express their freedom and humanity. This has been explored, albeit briefly, in Roger Scruton's interesting analysis of Eros and Agape in the Face of God. Scruton argues that it is through understanding the face that we see our subject, how subjects make themselves known in the world of objects. In defending the Christian understanding that marriage is a sacrament that marriage is a sacrament, and thus its purpose is to incorporate eros into agape, to ensure that the face of the lover can still be turned to the world of others. Roger Scruton claims that where marriage is not regarded as a sacrament and simply as a contract between groom and the parents of the bride, the face of the bride always remains hidden. So marriage, he says, does nothing to lift the woman from the private to the public form of love. And he then brings the burqa, the full veil, in this. That is a deep explanation of the burqa. It is a way of underlining the exclusion of women from the public sphere. They appear there as a bundle of clothing, but never as a face. To be fully a person, the woman must retreat into the private sphere, where eros, rather than agape, is sovereign. The Quran itself, like most scriptures, doesn't talk of male-female relations in the way we do today, within the paradigm of rights, but it does refer to mutual recognition. It says husband and wife are like garments for each other. The implication here is of mutual dignity and also of protection, where each is responsible to the other. Garments cover, beautify, and signify closeness to flesh. They can, of course, reveal and conceal, hide and allure, and sexuality is always present in this image. But in a religion where clothing has for so many retained a central place in defining the ideal image of Muslim piety and modesty, the concept of husband and wife being garments for one another is a potent and demanding depiction of complementarity. Marriage is a guardian of modesty for both. So if sexuality is central to the Muslim understanding of the self and conjugal relationships, so is modesty. The affirmation of sexuality and the sexual impulse is implicit in the marriage contract, but so is the recognition that sexual exists within the ethics of modesty. Modesty and sexuality contain a certain, even paradoxical, sacrality in the Islamic tradition, as both are regarded fundamental to the ideal of an Islamic society. Sexual transgression, therefore, goes against the personal integrity of both parties, rejects the social worth of marriage, and ultimately rejects the transcendent realm of God's desired order. Notwithstanding the imperative of sexual union, marriage requires more than the ability and willingness to consummate the union. And it is here that one can explore and emphasize the variety of human emotions which keep a marriage together. In his seminal work, Sexuality in Islam, Abdul Wahab Bodiba discusses at length the centrality but ambivalent dimensions of sex and sexuality in Islam, which he describes as the serious and the ludic, the social and the individual, the sacramental and the historical. Bodiba explains, through sexuality, the whole human being is taken seriously. This is why so much attention is paid to it. Sexuality has to be taken seriously because it bears witness to the seriousness of existence. One should marry, one should have sexual intercourse, parents must marry off their children, and among the duties of filial piety is that of getting a widowed parent to remarry. Marriage as that most central and intimate relationship proves a particular challenge for understanding relationships and fidelity. And I say this with specific relevance to marriage in Muslim societies. The issue of chastity and abstinence before marriage may be a pious ideal, but Islamic history and contemporary Islamic societies show that it remains just that, an ideal. Many are oblivious to the complex history of sex and sexuality in Islamic societies. In his recent work on sexual desire in the Arab world, Joseph Massard surveys a wide variety of literature, including the psychoanalytical, to show how Arabs represented their own desires. He portrays a variety of sexual behavior in practice in Arab societies and literature, challenging Western perceptions of either licentiousness or prudishness. While Arab is not the same as Islamic, Bodiba's sophisticated work also argues how the openness of an originary Islam was corrupted by the practice of the segregation of the sexes, which led to an increasing promiscuity. It is difficult for those, he says, who have not experienced it, to imagine what life under a strict separation of the sexes is like. But it is understandable that homosexuality, so violently condemned by Islam, could be so widely practiced among both men and women. The fact that homosexuality was always being condemned proves only one thing. Neither the religious nor the social conscience could put an end to practices that were disapproved of by Islamic ethics, but to which, in the last resort, society closed its eyes. Cousinage, prostitution, amorous intrigues of all kinds were inadequate to cope with the expression of desire that turned quite naturally to homosexuality. Budiba argues that the sexual ethic experienced by Muslims and the vision of the world that underlies it have less and less to do with the generous declarations of the Quran and the Prophet. He writes, "One can speak of a degradation which began at a very early date of an ideal model. The open sexuality practiced in joy with a view to the fulfillment of being gradually gave way to a closed, morose, repressed sexuality." While Islamic literature is reflective of Islamic societies in portraying all kinds of sexual relationships, there has been a tendency to regard marriage as the only faithful context for sexual life. The complexity of human desire has been lost in the insistence that heterosexual marriage alone provides the divinely sanctioned context for a sexual life. It is marriage which creates the context in which two people can share the mutuality of physical emotional needs. And so marriage without consummation, without the enjoyment of sex, has no place in Islam. Love in its carnal form transforms our being, and both men and women are seen as impotent without each other. Nearing the end. Gender egalitarianism may be interpreted in the cultivation of certain characteristics, including obedience, patience, and humility. The guarding of private parts is repeated throughout the Quran as extolling a specific virtue which sits ethically alongside other Quranic exhortations such as prayer and remembrance of God. So sexual virtue and piety seem to be inextricably linked. The taxonomy of actions which places fasting, remembrance of God, and guiding of private parts in the same category reflects the particular ethics in which the boundaries between the earthly and the transcendent come together in the virtue ethics of the Quran. Performing rituals such as fasting, remembering God, and retaining chaste behavior are all aspects of worship, and worship is always understood in the context of humility before God. It has been argued that if femininity is a socially constructed standard for women's appearance, demeanor, and values, then the body is a bare scaffolding on which discourse and performance build a completely acculturated being. If, as Skeggs claims, femininity is a process through which women are gendered and become specific sorts of women, this becoming is shaped by and dependent on the social, cultural, and religious environment one inhabits. That is, the definition and understanding of femininity is embedded within a particular cultural, social, and religious context. But I feel that our current emphasis on one or two issues in the Islamic world, such as veiling in all its forms, has become an unfortunate but central feature when discussing women, Islam, gender, the West, and of course, human rights. There is a disconnect here in the way we homogenize ideas of what it means for women to have rights, and that all women want all rights in the same way and with the same urgency. I'm well aware that I stand here speaking openly at a university only because of the struggle of earlier women, of earlier generations. But I do think that we are a little lost today. In modern societies where women and men of all backgrounds enjoy a much greater array of freedoms than was possible only a couple of generations ago, attitudes to sex and relationships, to gender stereotypes, have changed enormously everywhere, and this includes Muslim societies. In the West, cultural theorists analyze and often lament the effects of this changed lifestyle. Zygmunt Bauman comments on the isolation of sex from love, this most fundamental change which defines our liquid societies. And I quote, "Sex is now expected to be self-sustained and self-sufficient, to stand on its own feet, to be judged solely by the satisfaction it may bring on its own, even if it stops, as a rule, well short of this expectation. No wonder that its capacity to spawn frustration, to exacerbate the very same sensation of estrangement it was hoped to heal, has also grown enormously. Sex's victory is the great war of independence has been, in the best circumstances, Pyrrhic." Bauman quotes a short anecdote from the therapist Volkmar Sigush, who records the complaints and grievances of people who are the casualties of this kind of pure sex. All forms of intimate relationships currently in vogue bear the same mask of false happiness, once worn by marital and later by free love. As we took a closer look and pulled away the mask, we found unfulfilled yearnings, ragged nerves, disappointed love, hurts, fears, loneliness, hypocrisy, egotism and repetition, compulsion. Performances have replaced ecstasy. Physics are in, metaphysics are out. Abstinence, monogamy and promiscuity are all equally far removed from the free life of sensuality that none of us knows. I conclude. Christopher Lash argues in his 1970s classic, The Culture of Narcissism, as the mystery of sex has gone, the yearning for meaningful relationships has increased. Men and women now pursue sexual pleasure as an end in itself, unmediated even by the conventional trappings of romance. Our expectation of each other, of emotional and physical intimacy, may be just too high. And it seems to me that neither the feminist determined quest for rights and justice, nor the ideals of feminine which try to conceptualize what women should be and feel, have answers to these kind of dilemmas today. The Muslim world may seem as if it is all about veiling and segregation, but scratch the surface and you will find that despite a continued rhetoric of the ideal Muslim society, men and women face the same similar struggles. Thank you.